listen for the trumpet to sound most any time. And the crown of life that's waiting, thank God, will soon be mine. I've got my invitation from a place called Calvary. By the precious blood of Jesus, my trip's been paid for me.
Going home with Jesus in the twinkling of an eye. I've made my reservation for a mansion in the sky. I may not know the moment, and I may not know the day, but I know that I'll be leaving when he calls his trip away.
Well, the captain of the vessel, he's calling, get on board. And the destination's heaven, safe on the crystal shore. Well, we will meet our Savior and our loved ones who have gone. Then we'll live through all eternity. Praise God, I'm going home.
Jesus, in the twinkling of an eye, I've made my reservation for a mansion in the sky.
Praise the Lord. We may not know the moment and we may not know the day, but we know that we'll be leaving when he calls his church away. Amen. I'm ready. That can't come any day soon enough. Amen. Praise the Lord. I hope you're ready. And I hope you've made your reservation. If you haven't, you can fix that today. Amen. All you have to do is repent and place your faith and trust in Jesus Christ as your Savior and as your Lord. An invitation as simple as a child can receive it and put their faith and trust in him. And that's what he desires, simple childlike faith that we trust and obey in him. And that's available to any and all. And those who have done that this morning are here to worship him. We're not here to do church. We're here to worship the great and glorious God who has redeemed us and has saved us. So let's pray that our hearts are ready to worship him today in spirit and in truth. If you have a burden this morning, then we bring it and we lay it on the altar and we leave it here. We ask him for grace, and we ask him for his sufficiency in whatever we're facing right now, to give us the strength when we're weak and to give us wisdom where we need it. And so today he offers that to any and all as a burden, who have a carrying a burden today. Perhaps you need to come and intercede for someone who hasn't made their reservation. It's your burden that they would accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. I want to invite you to come and pray for them specifically by name. God's desire is that none perish but all come to repentance. So ask that God would do that in their heart today, that he would remove the blinders that have caused them not to repent and put their faith and trust in Christ, and ask that the Lord would open their heart to receive him so that they come to the knowledge of the truth. That is what God desires and God wills today. Also, today as we're praying, we want to pray for Brett Thomas and his family in the passing of his father this week, that God would comfort them and give them grace and strength and be near them. Whatever burden you have, let's go before the great and glorious God who's going to take us home one day, and let's celebrate that wonderful truth that we cherish in our hearts. Gracious Father, today Thank you that you keep your word. Just as you sent your son the first time, so too again he will come the second time in faithfulness to all you've written about him. God, may we never forget that we are your people and that you love us with an everlasting love and that you've promised that we navigate this world just for a few days and then we spend eternity in your presence. God, we look forward to that. We expect that to happen at any moment. God, I pray we're living like that each and every day. We, your people, come today to celebrate the one true God who's redeemed us and saved us and saved us for an eternal destiny around his throne. Father, today we ask that you'd be with the Thomas family in the passing of a father, that you would give them grace, that you would give them peace and comfort, and that, Lord, you would flood their hearts and minds with the sweetest memories of their dad. God, we come today praying and interceding for those who have not yet made their reservation for heaven. God, today we intercede for them because it's what you desire, that they come into the knowledge of the truth. So help them today to see and understand and know the truth about who you are, so they'll know the truth about who they are and their need for a Savior, and that Jesus is He. And God, today may our worship, may it reflect hearts that are excited for heaven, hearts that can't wait to be in your presence as we gather as the family of God here, along with all those around this on the globe today, Lord, who today on your Lord's Day celebrate the resurrection that has given us the victory and the assurance that we will get there because he has paid the price for us to get there. We love you. We praise you. We ask this in Jesus' precious name and for his sake. All God's people said amen and amen. Amen. Again, it's good to see you in the house of the Lord this morning. If you're visiting today, you're our special guest, and we just want to allow you to remain seated for a moment so that our church family can welcome you into the house of the Lord. If you're watching on Facebook, please let us know that you're watching, and so we can know how we're impacting your life wherever you may be around the United States or the world. We've discovered that. But at this time, I'm going to ask all of our church family, our brothers and sisters, to stand at this time to greet one another in the name of the Lord. Find those who may be visiting with us. Make them feel welcome in God's house this morning.
All right, well, let's gather back together. Guests, you can go ahead and stand with us. And we're here to worship the Lord and to express our love to him. Psalm 31:23 says this: "Oh, love the Lord, all you his godly ones. The Lord preserves the faithful and fully recompenses the proud doer. Be strong and let your heart take courage, all you who hope in the Lord. So as we worship Him, we love Him, and we express that love to Him because He first loved us. So let's sing and praise our great Savior.
There is a name I love to hear. I love to sing its word. It sounds like music in my ear, the sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because He first loved me. It tells me of a Savior's love, who died to set me free. It tells me of His precious blood, the sinner's perfect plea. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because He first loved me. It tells of one whose loving heart can feel my deepest woe, who in each sorrow bears a part that none can bear below. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because He first loved me.
Let's sing that chorus again, but slower, and sing it to Him, because He deserves our love and our worship.
Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because He first loved me.
And He showed that He loved us by giving His life on the cross as the only sacrifice for our sins. Jesus paid it all. Can't you rejoice in that this morning? Can I hear an amen? Jesus paid it all. Amen. Let's continue to worship Him.
One day when heaven was filled with His praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is He. The Word became flesh and the light shined among us, His glory revealed. Living He loved me, dying He saved me, buried He carried my sins far away. Rising, He justified freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day they led Him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed Him to die on. Suffering anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is He. The hand that healed nations stretched out on a tree and took the nails from me. Living He loved me, dying He saved me, buried He carried sins far away, rising He justified, freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day the grave could conceal Him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. Then He arose over death He had conquered. Now is ascended, my Lord evermore.
That will be a glorious day when he returns. Thank God we have that promise that he's coming back. Amen? Amen. We have that promise. And we have that promise in his word. And so when we open the word, we know that God speaks. But what we need to have, not just a heart to hear the word and that falls on fertile soil, but also we need to have the mind of Christ. And so when we look at the word, we should tell the Lord, Lord, would you give me your mind, your heart in this scripture so that you speak to me and it changes my life. So let's read his word together and realize how glorious our Savior is. Simon Peter answered and said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus answered and said to him, blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. Thank God we have the hope that hell cannot prevail against the church. Jesus saves. And we rejoice in his glorious name.
Lost are saved, find their way at the sound of your great name. All condemned, feel no shame at the sound of your great name. Your great name, the sick are healed.
that there is no other name above his name. One day every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you. Thank you today that your name is above all names, and you have made a way so that we could have life through Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord, for the salvation he brings to us. Thank you, Lord, for that message of truth that you give us to share with others, the fatherless, those who are broken, those who are far away, can be brought near through the blood of Christ, just like we have been, God. Lord, thank you. Thank you that we've shared that with hundreds of people just this week, and we'll continue to do next week and for several more weeks, as you've blessed us with the opportunity to feed our neighbors, to feed those around us, and to share the gospel. Lord, I pray that it will result in many coming to know you, Lord, because Jesus' name is above all names, and we lift you up and we praise you. Lord, as we give today, help us to give as an act of worship for your glory and for your honor. In Jesus' name, amen.
In and out of situations, the tug of war at me. All day long I struggle for answers that I need. Then I come into his presence, and all my questions become clear. And for that sacred moment, no doubt can interfere. Prince of Peace. the King.
Thank you, Miss Tammy. The children are dismissed to Children's Church. Pastor Scott's standing there to help guide you across the way for Children's Church this morning. And we're all taking God's copy of God's Word this morning and turning to the book of Revelation. And as we heard that song sung about dwelling in the presence of the King, praise God, His presence comes and dwells within us until we get to His presence in heaven. And He's promised us not only He's preparing that place, but He's given us His peace and His Spirit of peace to dwell within us. And He has secured us for His throne. And we will get there one day, beloved. Bank on it. It's found in the Word of God, the assurance that He is going to keep His Word. And so we trust in that. But there is one who dwelt in His presence, and He gives us a picture of what God is like. I know a lot of people would like to know what God is like. Some of y'all read that book, Heaven is Real, or watched the movie. And while that young man had those visions and dreams and said all those things, it was all a fraud, and admitted so later in his life, and everything that he had said. And so some people look at that and say, if I just saw Jesus like he saw Jesus, you know, I'd know how to live. Well, you don't have to turn to any of those books. You only have to turn to this book to get a picture of Jesus. And this book right here will tell you what Jesus is like. And we need to know what he is like. And we only see ourselves for who we truly are when we see God for who He truly is in His Word as He reveals Himself. And that's why we love to open God's Word and hear God speak to us, because He shows us who He is in His Word. And this book of Revelation is an unveiling. It's the apocalypse. God is pulling back the curtain and revealing not just the end times. A lot of times that we think that's what the book is all about. It's the revelation of the end times. And it is that, but that's not all it is. It is the revelation of Jesus Christ. It is an unveiling of God Himself. And in every chapter, as the end times are being unfolded and you're seeing what's going to happen, what you and I need to realize is that God is showing Himself for who He is. And only when you and I truly know who God is and what He is like will we order our lives the right way. And that's what He's trying to do. He's exposing Himself, revealing Himself in a grander and fuller vision, because this is the end of the story. This is the one to whom we have to deal with. And so let the truth of who God is expose us and reveal to us that not only heaven is real because He's found in the Word of God, but the God of heaven is real, and He's in my life, and He's shown me who I am and who I need to be and who He can make me to be. This unveiling is necessary, not just of the end times, but of God Himself. Because, see, the first time He came and dwelt among us in this way, God tabernacled among us, as John would say in his gospel. He veiled Himself with human flesh. Realize, God was fully divine. He added humanity to His deity. The kenosis in Philippians chapter 2 is not there. God made Himself less and subtracted Himself. No, He added humanity to His deity. He made man in His image, because one day He would fill that image with His presence, and then He would redeem those made in that image by dying the death on the cross that they, and paying the penalty they couldn't pay, and then rising from the dead. And so when Jesus veiled Himself, now He comes, and this is the unveiling. This is the second time that we're going to see Him. But we're not going to see Him veiled. We're going to see Him in all His glory. I mean, the Gospels don't have any picture of a description, a physical description of God, because God doesn't want us to merely see Him in His humanity. He wants us to see Him in His full glory. And see, when you and I really see Him in His full glory, that's what transforms your life. That's what changes my life. That's what changes the way I live and the decisions I make each and every day. And the way that I navigate the circumstances and trials that I might face, even if they're difficult and hardships, just as the church in John's day, when he's writing, when they were facing them. John is writing from the Isle of Patmos. He's writing as a prisoner in many sense because of the crime that he had committed. And you know what his crime was? He believed in Jesus. He held to the testimony of the Word of God, a crime in his day. It's going to be a crime in our day too, it seems like. To stand firm and not be ashamed of the name of Jesus Christ, and to stand firm on his word. As a consequence of his crime, they locked him up there on the Alcatraz of his day, Patmos, that Isle of Rock, and they just told him, go pound stone. That's what you're going to do for the Roman Empire. And in the midst of that, Jesus reveals himself to John, shows him in his full glory in many ways, reveals himself for who he is and all that he is preparing for us and how all the end times are going to take place. And the Bible teaches that those last days are coming soon. Be ready. That's the word. John would say it in his epistle, everyone who has this hope within him purifies himself and prepares himself for his maker, his creator, his redeemer, his king, who is coming soon. Now I want you to understand, listen, in John's day, the church was going through hardship. They were being persecuted. They were being prosecuted for being believers and not giving incense and burning incense to Caesar. They were suffering because of the faith, and they were going through what we would say is tribulation or hardship, not the great tribulation. We'll get to that in a couple weeks in the Word of God. I don't plan on getting to that in my life because of what I believe the Word of God teaches, but we'll get to that in a couple weeks. But today, see Jesus for who he is. Let our understanding of who he is as he reveals himself transforms the way you and I live each day. And it helps us to understand that even if we experience hardship, even if we experience difficulties, that this same God will get us through as it got John through and the early church through. And God will keep his word, and we will remain steadfast because of who he is and because he has changed us. Stand with me in honor of the word of the Lord. I'm just going to read verses 9 through 11, and hopefully we'll get all the way through the end of the chapter this morning if you'll buckle up. There's a lot of points here. I'll preach fast if you'll listen fast. Amen. I, John, verse 9, both your brother and companion, notice this, in the tribulation and kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ, was on the island that is called Patmos for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a loud voice as of a trumpet saying, I'm the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last. And what you see, write in a book and send it to the seven churches which are in Asia, to Ephesus, to Smyrna, to Pergamos, to Thyatira, to Sardis, to Philadelphia, and to Laodicea. Father in heaven, this word that has been written is written for your church. That's us, your bride. And Father, it is written because John has seen you and you have commanded him to write it so that, God, we can have a better vision of who you are so we can better understand who we are. God, today my prayer is that we are ready to see you as you are. Because, Lord, one day everyone will stand in your presence, either redeemed or lost. And, God, I pray today that if anyone in under the sound of my voice, Lord, whether it's in this sanctuary, whether it's on Facebook, whether it's on the radio, God, my prayer is if anyone today does not know you in a personal way as their Lord and Savior, then God, show them who you are so they will repent and believe and trust in you and discover eternal life, which is knowing you. We ask this today humbly in the precious name of Jesus, our Savior and coming King. Amen and amen. You may be seated. John writes as one who is suffering for the faith. He's there on the Isle of Patmos going through, as it says in verse 9, the tribulation. He is our brother and companion in it. This is not the great tribulation. Jesus had told him over in John 16:33 that the things that he had spoken to him, that in him you would have peace. But he said, but in the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer because I have overcome the world. Paul said in Acts 14:22 that we through much tribulation must enter the kingdom of God. He doesn't say that through the great tribulation we enter the kingdom of God. He would tell Timothy in 2 Timothy, that all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution, affliction, difficulty. If you really live out the faith of Christ, it will not always be accepted by the world around us. They will not always accept what you and I believe based on the Word of God. In fact, they will find us to be hindrances to the one world order. They will find us to be hindrances to their social plans, and they will find us hindrances to their immorality and idolatry. And yet God says to you and says to me through John that he has a companion that's going through it. He's our companion, and when we experience it, we can know this, that the same God that walked with him through it will walk with you and I through it. And I believe there are many in the church today, not just here at South River Baptist Church, but in the church in a broad sense, who will fall away, as it says in the book of 2 Timothy. That will happen in the end times. Wanting their ears itched, wanting their ears tickled, they will not have sound doctrine. That's why we preach the Word of God here from children right now in children's church, the students, adults in Bible study classes, and in the sermon on Sunday morning, Sunday evening, and Wednesday night. We preach the Word of God because we want sound doctrine. We need that plumb line for life. And it's only when we preach the Word of God that we truly see God for who He is, and then we truly know who we are and what we're supposed to be like. Well, what do I need to know, Pastor Chris, about who God is and what He's like should the time of tribulation or hardship come upon us here in the church in America? What do I need to know about God so that I stand fast and I don't fall away? Because you know what? The time is close at hand. You can see and read the tea leaves that are all there in the events in world history. You can see the birth pangs that are shaking the earth right now, whether it's the earthquakes or the asteroids that are flying all around us, whether it's the rise of the false prophet and the Antichrist, which appear to be on the horizon at some point. You and I don't live, though, looking for the Antichrist. We want to keep looking for the Christ. We fix our eyes on Jesus, and we run the race. So let me help you to fix your eyes on Jesus this morning as John exposes and reveals who he is, as he revealed to him. John says, Jesus said to John, listen, like the sound of a trumpet, he spoke to him and he says, I have a message for my churches. These churches there in modern day Turkey, it was called Asia Minor at that time. I've been to all seven churches there. Some still are just big fields. There's not much there. They're just heaps and mounds. Some actually have the churches or the remains of the empire that were there, and you can see that. But John says, I've got a letter to the seven churches, one letter. It's going to go on a circuitous route, and it's going to go to all these churches. And as it goes to those churches, they're going to hear this word, and they're going to be encouraged, and they're going to be emboldened in their faith, and they're going to stand fast. And God's going to speak to the seven churches, and we'll cover that over the next couple of weeks in chapters 2 and 3. But John was holding on to this word, holding on to the testimony of Jesus and suffering for it. But here's what God said. Let me show you who I am, so that you understand that all the events that are going to be unveiled, you'll know who I am and who's in control and how it's going to come to pass and why it's going to come to pass. Who is this King of Glory that we worship this morning? Who is this King of Glory that we celebrate today? John hearing him, John knew him. He saw him face to face in his humanity, but he never saw him in this way. Yes, he was the one that he heard him when he was walking on the side of the Sea of Galilee. He said to him, hey, follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. This is the voice that spoke to him, and this is the one that he saw teach the parables, perform all the miracles, do the healings, calm the sea. This is the one that he saw preach on the Mount of the Sermon on the Mount. This is the one that he laid his breast upon at the Lord's Supper. This is the one that he saw as he watched him die on the cross and said, here, behold your mother, his own mom, entrusting him to John's care. This is the one that he saw raised from the dead when Thomas doubted and said, let me just put my hand in your side. It's been 60 years since he's seen that Jesus, and he's going to see Jesus as he's never seen him before. He's going to see him in a way that he can't even put words to describe it. All he can say is, he was like this, like this, like this, like this, like this. Why? Because human language cannot fully express what our God is like. Our God is so infinite, so incomprehensible, that for anyone to say, oh yeah, let me tell you what he's like, we're limited in that way. Get a big vision of who God is, an awesome God. We have this God we think we can just describe and put in a box, and we got him figured out. Beloved, he's so much more than that. And John exposes him and reveals him as God reveals himself and unveils himself to John. What does he say? Well, I want you to see him in his full majesty. I turned to see, verse 12, the voice of the one who spoke to me. And having turned, I saw seven golden lampstands. And in the midst of the seven lampstands, one like the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the feet and girded about the chest with a golden band. His head and hair were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes like a flame of fire. His feet were like fine brass as it's refined in the furnace, and his voice is the sound of many waters. He had in his hand, in his right hand, seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp, two-edged sword, and his countenance was like the sun, shining in its strength. This is the majestic God. You and I, when you try to fathom what God is like and understand him in your mind, the best thing you and I can do is run to the Word of God and just meditate on what he says about himself as he is describing himself, unveiling himself to us through the words that John has given us. That is the best thing you can do. And when we see him in this way, in his majesty, what I see is one who is in complete control and in the presence of his people. He is the one who is there with the seven golden lampstands. What are those? Well, it's amazing. Many times in the book of Revelation or in other passages of Scripture, particularly Daniel and Zechariah and Ezekiel, you'll find written in there the explanation for many of the things that we're going to find as we go through the book of Revelation. Down in verse 20, we know what the seven lampstands are. He says there that the seven lampstands are the seven churches, and that the stars are the angels of the seven churches. These seven churches, this is God in the presence of his people, the Son of Man. The seven lampstands, the picture there is not seven distinct lampstands. It's one lampstand, much like a modern-day Jewish menorah, where there is one lampstand, and then off of it branches that come out, and seven lights. You will recall that Jesus gave us two pictures of that in John's gospel. He said that he was the light of the world in John chapter 8, and he said that he was the vine and we are the branches. And that's the picture you should have there of that lampstand, that there is one who is in the midst giving and making the light possible as we are his people and we're just reflecting his glory. That's who the church is supposed to be, reflecting the glory of the majestic one. That's how he designed us, and that's what we were made for eternity to do. And this one stands in the presence of his people, majestically there. He is standing. Even though John sees the seven golden lampstands, he sees one like the Son of Man. Well, who's the Son of Man? This is the term that you find Jesus referring to himself time and time again. Is that what he's referring to over in the Gospels? As Jesus says, the Son of Man came, the Son of Man came. Is that where we get the interpretation? Yes. And then beyond that, we go over to the book of Daniel. And over in the book of Daniel, in chapter 7 and verse 13, Daniel has a vision where he sees the Son of Man who comes to God. And this is Jesus. And now we're seeing the fulfillment of it, because all of these descriptors that you find, you see many of them reflected over there in Daniel chapter 7. So what we have here is a picture of Jesus Christ that is confirmed in Scripture, and God is unveiling himself as he did even to his people through the book of Daniel. And what God is trying to expose and reveal about himself is this: I am there with my people. Praise God. He never leaves us. He never forsakes us. And I need to know that, and you need to know that when difficult times come. Not just persecution of the church, just difficult times in general, right? I need to know my God is faithful. He is a good shepherd, a faithful shepherd, and he is always present with his sheep. He never leaves us nor forsakes us. In the Old Testament, we have this picture also of this one that stands there clothed with a white garment down to his feet and girded about the chest with a golden band. Who is this one, this majestic one that stands there? Well, he's our priest king. He is the one who stands, much as the as his robe is a picture of the priest who served in the temple, or as Isaiah would say in Isaiah 6, when he saw the vision of God, he saw the robe that filled the temple with his presence there, and he celebrated that. And that robe is a picture of one who stands now at the right hand of the Father, praise the Lord, interceding for you and for me. He is our high priest, the high priest that we run to. Listen, beloved, you don't run to me for forgiveness of sin. You don't run to another priest for forgiveness of sin. We run to the high priest, Jesus, for the forgiveness of our sins. We run to him and we confess them and we forsake them, and it's only through him that we find forgiveness and cleansing. We run to that high priest. And why? Because that high priest was also the lamb that was offered as a sacrifice for our sins. And he's the one that has paid the penalty for our sins and paid it completely. This is the high priest dressed in his robe. Now, what's amazing is that robe evidently flows all the way down to his feet. Why would that be significant? And why would he be girded about the chest with the golden band? Well, when you go over to the book of the Old Testament and you see the picture of who the priests were like, what they were dressed as, in their garb, they had a belt, but it was often said it was girded about their waist, because they would hoist up some of those garbs in just a little bit, and they would walk around and do service in the temple. But the reason that it's up around the chest is that now there's no more service that's needed in that way. Praise God, the sacrifice has been offered. Praise God, nothing more has to be given. The girdle about the chest speaks that there's one who has done everything that's necessary. Praise the Lord this morning. Beloved, if you're trying to earn your way to heaven, you're never going to find satisfaction doing it. You're never going to think you've arrived. You can rest today in one who's completed everything that's necessary and put your faith and trust in him. His hair and his head, it says in verse 14, were white. Now see this, like wool. He's going to say this. I went in my Bible and I circled like seven times. Like, all the way down through there. Why? Because I'm always reminded of this symbolic language that I can never fully describe him. Even in my preaching this morning, I cannot fully describe everything there is about him. And John says we can only get about like this. This is the best we can do. And you know what that does? Listen, that just keeps me humble before him, right? It keeps me humble and realizes you're so much more. By the way, that's why we keep pursuing him, to discover so much more about him. He is like this. His head and his hair were white like wool. Why would that be significant? Well, white always talks about his purity. When you go over to the book of Isaiah, of course, Isaiah would have that picture of the glorious Lord. But even in Isaiah, he would remind us that that it's Jesus who takes our sin, though it's red as scarlet, right? And he makes it white as wool. He cleanses us. He purifies us. And so we see Jesus here in his purity. But even more than that, the picture in Daniel chapter 7 is of the Ancient of Days, who also had his hair as white as wool. This is the one true God, the holy God, who always is and always shall be. Holy, holy, holy is the vision when you come into the presence of the Lord. There is no God like him. And we as his people, if we believe that, we should be purifying ourselves as his spirit sanctifies us, as we die to sin and present ourselves as slaves of righteousness unto holiness, because we're going to stand in his presence one day, a spotless bride. And we're going to be made pure because we can't make ourselves pure. But he, our God, has said, listen, you better have this vision of who he is, especially if you're a disciple of Christ, because Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount, your righteousness better exceed the Pharisees, right? Why? Because you're to be perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. You say, Pastor Chris, I can't do that today. I've stumbled, I've fallen short. Yes, so have all of us, amen? Here's the good news. You can exchange your unrighteousness for his perfect righteousness. Woo! You can exchange that at the cross, where he nails your unrighteousness to the cross and pays the penalty for your sin. And you can say, clothe me in your righteousness. Praise the Lord. We can do that. His head and hair are white as wool, pure, the eternal Holy One. His eyes, it says, are like a flame of fire. What in the world does this speak about? we realize when you see his eyes, John says they're just like fire. And what does that signify? Well, the picture there is that his eyes can perceive and burn up everything in your life and my life and sift and see right through it. And it will one day as believers, right? And the Bema Seat judgment, according to Paul in the book of Corinthians, when we as believers are raptured out, and yes, I'll get to that later, just hold tight. Not today, but you'll have to come back for that one. We will be raptured out, and we will have a judgment at the Bema Seat of Christ. You have to have time for that in your history of events here. You can't just go through everything in the Great Tribulation and then have the Great White Throne Judgment. There's no Bema Seat then. At the Bema Seat, you have the Bema Seat. And what happens at the Bema Seat? Every believer, listen, that is there, will be rewarded for their work on behalf of the Lord. You're going to be rewarded. I'm going to be rewarded for everything I've done for the kingdom of God while God has given us time. Those minas that he has entrusted to us, we have to give an account for that one day. You might have five, you might have two, you might have one. I don't know how many you have, but what you and I have to do is leverage all of that, our time, our talents, our tithe, all for the kingdom of God. And one day, we will stand before him, and what we have done, he will see right through it. Some of it will be wood, hay, and stubble. Some of it will be gold, silver, and precious stones, but all of it will be refined in that moment. Why? Because those eyes see right through everything. Now, you can fool the preacher, you can fool your bride, right? You can fool your friends for a little bit, but you can never fool God. He sees right through it. If he could see right into the hearts of Jesus when he was veiled in flesh and see the thoughts and motives of the Sadducees and the Pharisees as they were gathered there when he was doing healings and performing miracles, if he could see right through there and know their beloved, he can know us. And he sees right through us. But that's a healthy thing to know. You say, when I'm exposed then, God sees me. Yeah, that's right. Run to him. Because he's got open arms extended to us right now. An open hand reaching to us right now. Run to him. Don't run from him. There's mercy. There's grace. Don't run away. Don't be shocked by what you see when you see him in this way. Because see, it's in his light that we see who we truly are. But run to him and say, oh, I need you. Oh, I need you. And praise God he's there. He sees us. He sees every motive. He sees the secrets in our hearts. He sees everything. And he still sees everything today. His feet, it says, were refined as a furnace. They were like fine brass, refined in a furnace. Well, what's the significance of his feet and this brass feet that we have, this picture? And it's just like that. The picture he's saying is, listen, those feet are like bronze that have gone through the fire. They have gone through that for you and for me. And now they come and they are ready for judgment. Why? Because when you go back to the Old Testament, what you discover there in the temple is there the altar. The altar was made of bronze. Why? And those instruments that were used there for the sin offerings and for the burnt offerings, they had to be able to withstand the fire as the offering was presented. Well, Jesus stands as the one who's gone through the fire for us, and now he's going to bring judgment upon the world and the Babylonian system that rejects him because he's already brought the judgment for you and for me and paid the penalty for us. And only he can do that. And that's the assurance we have. Listen, that he appears in the midst of his churches and he is the one who can stand and deliver the judgment that is necessary and required for sin. And praise God, listen, when you bend your knee and you acknowledge Jesus as your Lord and Savior, what you are acknowledging is you have paid the penalty for me. You have taken the judgment of Almighty God. You have drank the cup of the wrath of God for me. I don't have to face any of that. You see, why would you go through the Great Tribulation and all that wrath if God's already taken the cup for you and for me? Let Scripture inform your understanding, the whole counsel of Scripture, inform your understanding of the events that are going to take place. Beloved, we were not appointed for wrath. We're appointed for a throne, and we're going to get there one day. His feet, though, were burnished like bronze. And out of his voice was the sound of many waters. This voice that sounds like a trumpet, this voice that sounds with such noise that it sounds like many waters. When I lived in New York, I had the privilege to go across Interstate 90 there over through Rochester and Buffalo to the very tip of New York. And there is Niagara Falls. If you've never seen it, it is amazing to witness. And as you go there, and when you could go on the other side of Canada right now, there's issues with COVID and all that other junk right now, and to get over there. But when you can go and see it and you stand there, you can't hear anything else because of the sound of 12 million gallons of water going over the cliff every moment. And you're listening to this 12 million cubic feet of water per minute. And the sound is so loud that you can't even hear the other one person speak next to you. It's amazing. That's the sound of God's voice when He speaks. He speaks with such authority, the voice of Jesus. And listen, though individuals today don't hear the voice of God when He speaks, a deaf ear, they turn to Him. They don't want to accept Him. They don't want to listen to what He has to say. One day, every voice will be silenced, and only one voice will be heard. And He will speak with full authority, and when He speaks, that same voice that spoke the world into existence will speak one word, and this world will be taken out of existence. It'll be totally transformed, burned up, and He'll create a new heaven and a new earth. This is the voice, listen, that John heard say, "Follow me, and I'll make you fishers of men." This is the voice that John heard when he asked him, "Who's going to betray you?" And he dipped and he said, passed it to Judas, and he saw, identified him. This is the voice, listen, that heard Jesus on the cross when he cried out, "Tetelestai, it's finished." This is the voice that spoke to him and said, "Peace I give to you," there in the upper room with the disciples when they were hiding in fear and he appeared to them. This is the voice, listen, that one day will say one of two things to you and me. He will either say, "Depart from me, I never knew you," or He will say, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Everyone will hear one of those two things. I'm looking forward to hearing, "Well done, good and faithful servant." That's what I want to hear my Savior say to me. That's how I want to live my life, hearing that voice speak to me. That's why I pour my life into ministry. That's why you should be pouring your life out into your family, into those around you, in ministry as God draws your boundaries, because, you know, we just want to be found faithful. And I want to hear that voice of commendation, not condemnation, one day. His hand, in His right hand, He held the seven stars. Now, what does that mean? Well, the seven stars, who were they? Well, if you go down in verse 20, "The mystery of the seven stars which you saw in my right hand and the seven golden lampstands," the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches. The angelos, the messengers, the stars represent the voices, the messengers who speak to the churches, who bring God's word and speak to the churches, and perhaps it's the pastors of the churches. Now, I know you never knew your pastor was an angel, but don't worry, April keeps me humble, okay? The picture here is Jesus holds His messengers in His hands. He holds the messengers who bring His word and speak His word to His churches. And He is in full authority and full control and has them in the palm of His hand. And if I'm going to go through hardship and difficulty, I want to know that I'm in the center of His hand and that anything that happens to me is filtered through His fingers and He's in full control of it. And that is the assurance that you and I need. It's what John needed to know. It's what these churches needed to know, where this letter was going to be sent and circled around and spread to each one so they could hear this promise and this unveiling of what God was going to bring about. It comforts my heart that I am safe in His hands. The hands that made everything. The hands that wove me together in my mother's womb. The hands that have orchestrated all the events of my life and is working them all together for good. I am absolutely safe and secure in His hands. And beloved, you should know that today as well. You have to put your hand in His hand, though, by repentance and faith, and say, "Save my soul." His mouth, out of His mouth comes a sharp, two-edged sword. What is that? Well, it's don't think of, you know, a sword coming out. It's like that, right? Well, what do we know about the sharp two-edged sword? Well, elsewhere in Scripture, we know that the sharp two-edged sword is the Word of God, and that just makes sense. What would come out of His mouth but the Word that He speaks. When our God speaks, it's like a sword. It just cuts right through you if you truly hear it. It exposes exposes us. That's what the book of Hebrews says. Over there in book of Hebrews, it speaks to every man, and it's speaking to a generation that had a hard heart and didn't want to hear what God had to say and didn't want to surrender to what God had to say and believe it. And it says there that that word exposes every creature. We're all exposed by it. And it's kind of like when you're wrestling with someone, it says literally there that it's like grabbing the head, someone in a headlock, and turning them up, turning them over so they have to look up at the lights. And the lights just shine in and expose us. So we don't act like brute beasts who go through life not recognizing the Creator who's speaking, but that we stop and we look up and we realize there's a holy God up there. And He's speaking to us. And that word speaks, and that same word we'll discover later in the book of Revelation is the word He will speak, just one word, and He'll destroy all the armies arrayed against Him. Those who shake their fist at Him, those who reject His word and don't want to acknowledge Him, they one day will be annihilated when He just speaks one word. That's how powerful our God is. Listen, that same word can change your life today. That same word can transform your life. If you and I will just repent and say, God, speak to me, transform my life. How does He do it? It's the same way Paul would say in the book of Ephesians. We put off the old and we put on the new by renewing our mind. How? With the word of God. We meditate on the truth. And it's this word that is transforming us. And it's one day the word that He will speak that not everyone will accept. But as the great judge, He will judge men someday, and He will just speak a word. And then finally, He says this, His countenance or face was like the sun shining in its strength. There it is, like again. The face of God's glorious one. Listen, you can't even look into the sun without going blind. And you will not be able to look upon Him without being blinded in many ways as you look to Him. And what happens when you come into His presence? He's unapproachable. He veiled Himself so we could see Him. And one day we'll be able to see Him because we'll be like Him. But John's not like Him yet. But one day we will be. And we'll be able to see that glorious presence and not be blinded by it. But right now, praise God, He reveals enough about Himself so you and I can say, I need to put my trust in Him. I need to rest in what He has done. And when He comes, sinful men will not even want to look upon Him. They'll be hiding, you'll discover. They'll be running into the caves. They'll say, we don't want Him, we don't want it. And He'll say, let the mountains fall on us that we may die. And that's not how God wants you to be. God reveals Himself to you and me so that we run to Him, not run away from Him. You see, in this glorious bright light that shines, He exposes and reveals us. And beloved, while we be ashamed of what we see, we don't have to be ashamed. We can run to Him and say, that's why your son died for me. I plead the blood. I want the blood on me. Wash away my sin. You see, this is who He is in His majesty. And now you see Him in His mercy, because when John saw Him, verse 17, he fell at His feet as dead. But He laid His right hand on me, saying, do not be afraid. I'm the first and the last. I'm He who lives, was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys of Hades and of death. John's reaction is the reaction you find all through Scripture when individuals have come into the presence of the Lord. They fall on their faces as dead. If you and I saw a vision like this, God in all of His glory and His majesty, we would fall on our faces as dead. And yet, mercifully, the Master reaches His hand and puts His hand on John and tells him, do not be afraid. I am the first. I am the last. I am He who lives, was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. I am the reigning, resurrected one. And I want to reassure you, you do not have to be in fear. Now praise God that God can touch us with His hand, beloved, and we don't have to live in fear. You don't have to fear anything today. Why? Because you know the one who is the first and the last. You know the one who is the author of your faith, the perfecter of your faith. You know the one who is before all things and the end of all things, and your life is in Him. You know the one who was dead, who lives now, and behold, He's alive forevermore. He is the resurrection and the life. You see Him in this way, you see Him mercifully in this way, touch your life, and you realize my faith is resting in Him. What do I have to fear? What do I have to fear? This is the one, listen, don't fear the one who can destroy the body. You fear the one who can destroy the soul, right? This is the one, though, that says you don't have to be afraid, John. You can know peace, the peace that I've spoken to you. You can know the peace in the midst of what I'm going to reveal to you. And John, you can stand now because I know you and you know me. I've never changed. I am the all. I am the first and the last. Not only that, John, I have the keys to Hades and death. You see, he's already conquered the grave, y'all. He has the keys, the authority. He's the one who opens and he's the one who binds. He's the one who has the full authority. This is incredibly important for the people who were being persecuted at that time because they weren't in authority. Caesar was in authority and he was the one that was locking them up. He was the one that was punishing them with death. And yet Jesus says, no, I'm the one who has authority over all of that. I have those keys. And no one is snatching those keys out of my hand. You see, praise God. It's all in his hands. I'm in his hands. My life is in his hands. Hades and death is in his hands. He's got it all, beloved. Why would you want to try to control your life? Why not surrender to his hands today? I don't understand. Now, he gives us one last key here when he finishes in verse 19. And I have to give you this key before we close. This is the key to the rest of the book. Because he says, write the things which you have seen. What are the things which he has seen right now? He has just seen the majestic, glorious God. He has just seen his high priest. He has just seen Jesus, and he can't describe him. And he says, write the things you have seen. And the things which are, what are the things which are? Well, that's the second category. That's chapters 2 and 3. That is what is happening in his churches, the things that are. And then write the things which will take place after this. Well, what will take place after this? Well, that's verse 4, chapter 4, verse 1, when it says, after these things I look. And you will find there from chapter 4 to chapter 19, well, the picture of heaven and the picture of earth. And you will have the picture of the great tribulation that God's people will not go through. At least the church will not go through because she'll be snatched away. You won't see her on any of those pages. But what you will see is God dealing with the nation Israel and those tribulation saints, those who come to faith because of their witness in the great tribulation. But that's not for the church. God has a word for us. These are the things that are, and they're the things that you and I need to deal with. And over the next several weeks, when we see the pictures of the seven churches, we'll be able to see a reflection of who we are and our heart and our commitment to the Lord and our faithfulness or our not faithfulness in serving him. And the need for us to do is he'll speak to every church to repent and get right. And that's always the message for the church. If Christ is coming again soon, we should be preparing ourselves for his coming. And that will always be a lifestyle of repentance, a recognition that we sin and fall short of his glory every day. But we should be growing closer and closer to him and desiring to live in a way that is pleasing to him. Should be. But that's the question today. Because if I really see God for who he is, then he will expose me and I'll see, God, there's something right there in my life that you're working on. I need to repent of. And the altar needs to be filled more frequently with those who are saying, God, have mercy on me. God transforms my life. Transform my life. I've heard you speak today and I realize who you are. The proper understanding for this whole book hinges on what we see right here in chapter 1. Not just the hermeneutical key in verse 19 that tells us the timeline of things that are, have seen, will are, and will be, but also the mystery is this. You and I, unless we have a proper understanding of who God is and what he's like, you and I cannot understand all the events that are going to take place on this earth. Because those things are going to be even greater revelations of the nature of our God, the essence of who he is. And beloved, it's written so that you and I say, praise God, we're not going through that. But I am going to do this, what Paul said in Corinthians. Knowing the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. You see, you, church, if you and I really believe this is what's going to happen, We should be persuading others, beating the bushes, standing in the highways and byways, imploring them, come while there's time. There's a day of judgment that's coming. You need to be ready. The world needs to be ready. Christ isn't going to, you know, change his plans. It's all written down for us. And the world needs to be ready. But right now, you and I need to be ready. Our hearts need to be ready. And if there's never been a time where we said, God, have mercy on me. I'm a wretched sinner. Save me from my sin. I've not trusted in you. Then today's the day to say, I want to put my faith and trust in Christ. I want to repent and believe in him. And that's why we have a moment of invitation, a decision, an opportunity for you to decide to walk by faith. We open that invitation to any. There's some who today, listen, they need to lock arms with us here at South River Baptist Church. You're already saved, but you need to get engaged so that you can be found well done, a faithful servant, serving the Lord faithfully with the means that he's given you, the time, the talent, and tithes, so that one day, you know what, you can say, look, I've leveraged all this for your kingdom, and it was so worth it. And maybe God has led you here. You're already a believer, and you need to lock arms with South River Baptist Church. Maybe you need to sneak down on the altar because there's someone that you're burdened for. They're not ready for eternity. They're not ready to appear before the Lord. And you just want to pray your burden for their salvation. Have you pled for them? Weep tears for them? Have you said, God, save their soul? And Lord, help me to be a witness to speak to them. See, right now, everyone is going to do something with truth. Either you're going to accept it, believe it, and act upon it in faith, or you'll reject it. Now, the danger is this. If you harden your heart at truth, the next time the seed comes, the soil is not ready to receive it. We don't want to be in that position. So as God's word is spoken to you today, respond in faith and respond in obedience. If the Spirit of God has spoken to you right now, then respond to him in obedience. We do that by bowing our heads and closing our eyes and saying, God, search me and try me and know me and search me through and through. But our desire, as it is with David, Lord, lead me in the way everlasting. What is that everlasting path for you this morning? What is it that God would have you do? If you've never repented and placed your faith and trust in Jesus, but today you realize you need to ask Jesus to be your Savior and Lord, then we invite you to come and make that known to the church. In the second service, we'll be baptizing too.